I'm sorry.
If you would like to get your song reviewed, dear listener, there's the Filthy Capitalist option. It's sorry says 125 gets you straight to the head of the line. You don't have to be a part of the lines. You don't have to be part of the group.
Wait a minute.
And the biggest thing is you don't have to wait. You hop, skip, and jump right in front of everybody. 125 gets you there. You do that 3 times and then get mashed down to the $75 rate for perpetuity.
Yes!
Also, there is a band review option. So if you've got a band and you're trying to get your band some exposure, hit me up at insori@gmail.com and I'll show you the details about how to pull
you
that off.
You can also jump on Patreon and there is a option on the tiers to be able to get your band reviewed. Yep. Obviously, we can't lie to you, so we can't guarantee a positive review. Get what you get.
It's just rubbish.
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 That's British for garbage.
My favorite is the community option. $1 at the gate gets you in a Patreon. You get to join an alliance. The alliance joins their points together, and that helps determine what songs that we do.
The alliances hang out on Discord.
Message me on Patreon to get the link.
And they do all kinds of other cool things. They do Minecraft. What? Dungeons and Dragons.
Yeah, yeah. It's really a community within the community. Anybody can go on the village, facebook.com/vinandsori. There's 160,000+ people on the channel. What's cool about the Discord is that it offers a real opportunity for community, connection, friendship, that type of thing.
And it's on Discord, so if you're not a Facebook person, it's for you.
You start off at $1.
Right.
Plus you get exclusives. Sori and I are working on a song. So the first 15 seconds of that was on Patreon. Also, at $15 tier and above, when we actually debut the video, they're going to be there live with us. There you are, dear listener.
Buy our merch.
Hi.
And the child shall lead them to buy our merch.
Excellent. Okay, we are about to review the next song on the Lone Ranger list.
Yes.
And that is, this is a great live performance from Seven Dust titled Come Down that has a very sweet moment in it. So, let's look for the sweetness.
A sweet moment, yeah. You say. A sweet moment.
Mm. I'm ready for some sweetness.
Huh. You are sweetness. Sweetness, where you park that?
Oh, I didn't think you got that. Lend me your cheek. I'm pretty sure the Bible says you're supposed to turn the other cheek, so turn it. Give me the other one.
No. I've had enough. Now.
All right, ready?
The moment has arrived. Tony the Lone Rider Smith's favorite band, Seven Dust. The time has arrived.
The original name was Crawl Space? That's interesting.
Really? That's really, really interesting.
Yep. Okay, let's go.
Okay, Seven Dust, the time has arrived. We are listening to
Seven
that
Dust,
song.
Come Down.
Come Down. And it's a live performance, which is really fun because you guys know how Vincent is about live performances.
I need to see everybody's hands in the air. And let me see you dance a little bit too. It's a song called Come Down. Would you like to hear it tonight? Would you like to hear it?
Yeah.
I guess for now, I'm gonna hope and run away. My mind's made up. Oh, I'm not the floor. I'm not gonna fall to the grave just to where you are. Hey, you know you're wrong. Listen. Is that okay? Come on, let me see it like this. Come on, come on. Feet on the ground. So calm down. can hear forever. Yeah. I wonder what man. Are you okay? You hanging in there?
Aww.
What are you talking? Aww.
Let me see it like this. Come on. Give her.
Talking to a kid?
Yeah.
Did they show the kid?
No, I didn't see the kid.
He said, "What's up, little man? You good?"
Yeah.
Where did he say that? Oh, there he is, right there.
You okay, little man?
You see it? Hey!
Okay, little man.
Kid, they lift up this kid on the shoulder.
Oh, yeah.
I'm gonna make it bigger. You see it, guys?
You okay, little man? Are you okay? You
I love that shit, bro.
Aww.
Look, you can see him kind of looking over there. You see? He's looking at the side.
Yeah.
Look, see, there he is right there.
You okay, little man? Are you okay? You hanging in there?
Look at him. Oh, I love
that. Let me see it like this. Come on.
I love that. I love that. I love that.
So, I'll say this. We were at one of these shows, and
it was
basically, you know, it doesn't matter. That's one time. But
yeah.
Basically, it doesn't matter. Anytime we go to a show, I'm like, Vin always finds some younger kid there. That you're always like, should that kid be here without his parents? I don't know. He might be a little young. And he'll get them water and he'll just make sure that they're good the whole show, that they're not getting squashed. It's super cute, I think. And then here this guy was doing the same thing. I'm like, what?
That was my little homie at the Slipknot show.
Yeah.
We'll make sure he was good.
Yeah. It was cool. So this guy, okay. I love his voice. I love the song. So I saw this thing one time where the person was in the studio and they were singing and they sounded good. And then the manager or whoever the person was that was in charge was basically like, no, I want to see more from you. And they were like, I can't. But they wanted them to break from the barrier that was holding back all the feeling that was behind the song that they were singing. And she kept pushing her and pushing her and pushing her until she finally started singing with so much, like she would not accept anything that was below what she felt like this person was capable of. And I think when I watch his stuff, I'm like, friggin', if you were there, I feel like you'd push him more to go, like his voice is so good. I just think that there's more emotion and shit that can come from him.
Yeah, I mean, he...
Like, he performs great. He did great. Audio was great, blah, blah, blah. I just think that there's more. I think there's more from him.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And maybe he has other songs where he does more, but...
He's got a very, very powerful voice. Very vocal. And, you know, it's really interesting because I talk about, like, the new metal era in metal. And, I've said pretty much Slipknot and Korn are the only survivors from that entire... I mean, there were, like, 9,000 bands at the time.
Mm-hmm.
But... Seven Dust is also a band that's still around, still playing, still making music, still selling out. And LaJohn has a solo album coming up, apparently. So yeah, there are a couple songs. You know, Sean just talked about it. There's a song, Angel Son. It was about Lynn Strait. This guy died.
Thanks, Corey.
Died in a car accident, and so like his band had already recorded all the, so they just needed the vocals. So you had Jonathan, LaJohn, Corey, they all did a record, and they all, every single one of those songs balled. They were so good. They balled out every single one of them. But LaJohn has, okay, I'm going to make a Maynard comparison, and all the Tool fans, don't go crazy. I'm not saying that he's got the vocal range of Maynard. I'm just saying that Maynard is one of those guys that people try to copy, but it's just him, and it's not that he hits notes in ways other people don't hit notes. It's the combination of what Maynard can do in the backdrop of metal, because there's so much. So, like, if you look at LaJohn, I was thinking about, like, even the way he dresses pretty much matches his vocal style.
Mm-hmm.
Like, if you look at that video again and just watch how he's dressed. You know, he's dressed like a very good-looking... You know, that to me kind of summarizes what he can do vocally. Like, he can be sleek and jazzy and hit notes and all, and he's got that like 80s R&B thing that they do in the 80s. But at the same time, he's a metal singer. He can go to a growl, and you won't be able to tell when he's going to do it.
Yep.
And you know, it's one of the things that I really, really value in singers that makes me so excited to work with you, because there's so many things that you can do that are completely unpredictable.
Well, that's why I said you could work with him, because I didn't know the thing. It was unpredictable to me too. I didn't know I could do the things that you were like, okay, now do this. And I'm like, oh, okay. And I tried it.
Yeah.
And you don't let me stop. You know what I mean? Like, I'm like, I don't know, Vin, that's as much as I got. That's it. And you're like, no. And you keep pushing me. And then all of a sudden we come out with this sound that we're like, that's it. That's the one we want.
That's the one.
And I'll be like, you're right.
That's the one. Yeah, exactly.
Go until you pass out. That's Vin's running philosophy.
Well, that's what I was telling Johan.
I know. They were running on the beach, and he told Johan, he was like, look, buddy, I know you're tired, but you're going to have to go until basically you have body fail, and just go till then. As soon as you gave him that information, he had body fail about 20 seconds later. I think he just wanted to be done.
Ridiculous.
Video is on TikTok if you guys want to see it.
Ridiculous. Yeah. So lyrically... guess for now I'm gonna go and run away. My mind's made up. I'm not the flaw. I'm not gonna fall in the grave just to prove you're wrong. You know you're wrong. Good. This strange thing where people have to prove themselves to other people, I've never understood it. You know, like, I was listening to, I forgot, some UFC guy. He goes, well, I'm not trying to prove anybody wrong. I'm just trying to prove myself right. Like, and of course everybody says he's arrogant and things like that. It's like, that's the thing about arrogance. It's really funny to me. Like, people, like, if a lot of times when I see that word get thrown around, it's because the person will not submit themselves to the tyranny of everybody's opinion of them. So when a person runs into somebody who truly doesn't give a fuck about anybody's opinion, they'll immediately say you're arrogant.
Yeah.
Which
yeah, but I don't think what that guy said was arrogant.
We can't blackmail and control you. Well, he's saying, well, look.
He says, I'm not trying to prove you wrong. I'm just trying to prove myself right. But by definition, you're going to have to make everybody wrong. Yeah. I'm right. You're wrong. But
if you think about it, he's saying, I'm not the flaw. I'm not going to fall in the grave just to prove you're wrong. You know you're wrong.
Most like, people would. Babe, this sounds like you.
That's why I really like that song. like, that's.
You must be out of your mind.
Yeah, you must. Yeah. I was really enjoying that. And that was one of the things that was not hilarious to me. That's not the right adjective. But it was funny to me about the song because he's singing it in this, you must be out of your mind. But at the same time, it's like, you must be out your damn mind. You think I'm going to go down there with you?
He's not.
Nigga, you know you're wrong already. Nigga, what are you talking about? Like, you wrong already? Man, fuck out of here. Like, that's the shit you hear all the time, like, on the train and stuff. Like, you know, like in New York, you know, dudes like, man, you out your mind, bro. Like, and he's singing it in this, like, yeah.
Yeah.
I just love that. I love that about him. So come down. You must be out of your mind. Let's stay here forever until we're older. Done with life forever. So I think it's the other person saying stay. Notice it says come down.
Yeah, he said, but I'm not going to fall in your grave.
In verse one, he says, I'm not going to fall into your grave and go down there with you. But then in the chorus, it says come down. And I think the chorus is a conversation. Come down. And he's saying, you must be out of your mind. And the person says, let's stay here forever until we're older. Done with life forever. And I think LeJohn's like, nah, bro. The next verse is, right now I'm looking at heaven. You're not. You're spinning around. If I die young, I'll die with some love in my heart and my feet on the ground. Mm-hmm. Like, right now I'm looking at heaven. You're not. You're spinning around. So that's he's saying, I'm focused on what's right. You know, you're trying to bring me down, and I'm, you know, this is probably one of the more hyperbolic and dramatic ways of saying, you're trying to bring me down, but I'm not going to let you. I'm going to focus on the positive. Mm-hmm. So you're trying to bring me down into this grave. You're trying to pull me down into this grave.
Yeah.
I'm not going to fall in the grave just to prove that you're wrong. Which, you know, that's one of those things. That's one of those things, guys, where it's like this desire to prove other people wrong. Mm-hmm. You know what I think?
What?
I think because I have watched so many debates, like actual debates. Because I've watched, this is probably a low estimate. I've probably watched 5,000 hours of debates. It's probably a low estimate.
Ugh, yeah, probably.
But what happens is your mind gets trained a certain kind of way. When you've watched so many of them.
Oh, I'd agree with that.
So what happens is, and debates are so obvious, especially if you allow for a cross-examination, mm-hmm. which is why a lot of people won't do formal debates. Because in cross-ex, you can only answer the question, and you can't obfuscate. Mm-hmm. So what ends up happening is, you generally see the wheels completely fall off. Like, I'm not gonna bring up the specific issue because people are gonna get distracted by the topic. But there was a debate. It was a moderated debate that I actually did. And
you won't be able to find it. I'm sure it was deleted.
No, I didn't delete it.
Oh no, the other person.
No.
They always delete it. They always like suddenly their audio did something funny and they deleted it.
So, yeah. Different situation, but like there, you know, the guy ended up saying some really crazy stuff, and it just became obvious in the debate. So there's no reason to spike the football. There's no whatever. So, but that's how I look at all of life. I'm like, this shit is obvious.
Yeah, you're very much like that.
So I don't need to prove anything to you. It's everybody can see it.
Mm-hmm.
What and that it's a mystery to me. Like. And okay, so you've proved the person wrong. What does that mean? Like, are people going to come up to you and say, you know what? I was wrong because you just proved me wrong? I mean, don't people just go, they make up some excuse as to why, you know what I mean? So like, what are you seeking when you're trying to prove somebody wrong?
I think that's a good question. I really do. And I think that it's different depending on who you are and who you're talking to. because I don't think you're always trying to, like, so I noticed something, again, I was talking to you guys before. I've been looking into, like, a lot of philosophy and thinking, mm-hmm. and it's kind of broadening my mind to think about things a little bit bigger than I am, and I'm really, really enjoying myself. And so that one that I watched that I'm pretty sure Riverhead sent me, it was on, like, debunking an argument or breaking down an argument. But for me, it wasn't about, like, oh, how can I break down this argument so I can win the argument? Mm-hmm. I coupled that together with the other video that I was watching that was talking about romanticism and stuff and building, you know, types of relationships and expectations and how in relationships there should be a teacher and a student and that those roles will flip. So sometimes Vin is the one teaching me something and I'm the student, and sometimes I'm the teacher and he's the student. And the teacher has to have more patience than the student because they're the teacher. So if your student freaks out and doesn't respond well to you, it's because you were a bad teacher in that moment. And so there's times he's a bad teacher and there's times I've been a bad teacher. And I took that idea and now I'm using it with the kids. And I said before, we have one kid, he argues everything. And I always saw that as a negative thing. But now that I've been watching those videos, I'm like, no, he's trying to get to a point. So now the reason that I'm questioning or the things that I do is because I'm trying to find out where is he trying to go. And I think Johan is trying to teach me something. And so I'm going to let him teach me. And I'm going to try to learn what he's saying. And I can tell when it's not going well by if he's getting frustrated. Then I'm like, okay, I'm not hearing him. So what else is he trying to say? And so I don't even remember what the question was that got me saying all that. What did you just say? You were talking about when people...
Say, what are people looking for when they're trying to prove somebody? Like, what gets validated?
So in the past, whenever I had those conversations, the only thing that I was trying to establish was I'm the parent. And you're the child. And so you just make sure that we have those lines completely known. And so for me, it didn't really matter what they said or why they did whatever. It was just like, okay, I was kind of trying to make my life as easy as I could instead of trying to understand them and kind of grow with them and stuff.
Yeah.
And so now it's different. It's actually so much more interesting. I'm really enjoying my conversations with Johan because he's so brilliant. And people said it before when they saw him on the channel. They were like, wow, this kid is deep. And yeah. He is. He could do TED Talks in a couple of years, or now he could do them. But just listening to him is just, it's... So when your goal is to understand somebody, to teach and to learn, then you're going to get different results. But if your goal is you want to show everybody how right you are, sometimes you're unable to hear what other people have to say because you're too busy trying to prove that you're right. If you already know you're right, then you don't have to argue that. Try to listen to the other person and see if perhaps you're wrong.
Yeah, no, I agree. I agree completely. And you know,
oh, this comment section is so freaking funny right now.
He said, "If I die young, I'll die with some love in my heart." Which I don't know why, but for some reason, I interpreted the person he was arguing with as somebody older than him because of that line. If I die young, I'll die with some love in my heart. And it's not even the young part that makes me say that. I read this book. I've seen a bunch of movies and things like that where there's this conflict. The parent wants the child to be this one way and the child is like, come on, mom and dad, blah, blah, blah. And then it's back and forth and the dad is worried about the money and all this. And the kid's like, I'm just trying to be free. And then I could see him saying, well, at least I got some love in my heart, dad. You're, you know, whatever. But of course, there's nothing in the surrounding context of the song to say that. But he's obviously arguing with somebody who he is looking at as a person who doesn't know the ultimate purpose of life, which is relationships. Like, that's the ultimate reason that we're here, is to have relationships. Whether you look at it from a Christian worldview or even a secular worldview, shout out to Mr. Hoffman. It's clear that we're here for relationships. And so if you can master a whole bunch of things in life, man, like, go for it, bro. But if you don't know how to love people, you lost. Mm-hmm. And, you know, it sounds, you know, whatever. But, I mean, think about what we've all been through in the last year.
Mm-hmm.
And think about the psychological ramifications of people being trapped in their homes.
Yep.
And then on top of that, when they go outside, they're not able to get the full sort of, you know, it's weird. Like, there is this guy that we follow in another world, and I generally can't stand him. And I actually was about to go on his show. I was about to, like...
Really?
And the Lord was like, absolutely not.
You listened to him this time. That's good.
Yeah, that time I listened. I said, yeah. Because I was going to go in there and just be completely ethnic with the guy.
See, the thing is, Vin is the only person I've ever known that will just out and out say no to God. I've met lots of people that have said, you know, God doesn't exist. So that's their way of saying no to him. Some people say, I'm not really sure. That's another way of saying no. Vin will say, yes, I know he said that, but I'm not going to do it. So no, I just cannot believe
but
somebody's like that.
Yeah, but then you'll come up with some BS religious excuse for why you didn't do it. I feel like
feel
like God is just much better with me going, okay, well, you're dumb, Vin, but okay. Like, you know, I just throw myself on the mercy of the court.
It's the mercy of the court. This is, put him up on there. I was thinking that it was a relationship song, as in a male, female, or, you know, like, romantic relationship, I guess you could say. Oh my gosh, romanticism now. What am I supposed to do? There's so much to think about.
Well, I don't interpret romanticism as being completely a bad ideology. But Ripple came up with this himself, but, you know, thank you for attributing it to me. Don't go to hell to prove the devil wrong. That's a good line, bro.
That is.
That's probably the line of the...
That's the line of the year. That's
the line of the year right now. I'm going to put that shit in my other Facebook
page. Do it. Do that shit.
I'm like, that's why I didn't call into your show, you bitch. Because I'm not going to go to hell to prove the devil
yeah,
wrong.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. Because we already know you're wrong.
I got into a little something with him yesterday, and he abandoned shit.
The word it that way. I'm picturing him like with the bucket throwing the water out, and then when you said abandon ship, he threw the bucket and dove in. Oh, okay. Well,
so he, but my point is, like, we're all confined to the house, and then on top of that, honestly, like, so anyway, that's why I brought up the guy that I don't like. He put something on here like, I'm so happy to see people's faces. And I was like, that's true. Like, yeah. We took that for granted. And then when it was taken from us, it really does change everything. Like, to be in a world where you don't get to see people's face.
Yeah.
Like that is truly, truly. And, you know, C.S. Lewis has this book entitled Until We All Have Faces, which I'm only a quarter of because, like, I was into it. I went right after The Great Divorce. Mm-hmm. I went right into that one, and then BM Fan sent me the Communist Manifesto, and so ever since then, when I have free time, I'm reading Marx, mm-hmm. or I'm listening to Hoffman, or I'm listening to Stephen Meyer, or whatever. But that is true, like, not being able to see, and it's kind of weird, because we have a little rhythm, so, and as we live in a kind of a small town, so you know who the guy is at Applebee's, you know who this guy is, and they're used to seeing you, like... I came in a couple days ago and she's like, this is the second time you've been here, blah, blah, blah. Like, they, you know, and like, but you don't see anybody's face. Like, that's hard, you know? And so, like, all that does is drive home the point that we're all here for relationships.
Yeah.
And even if you're the most introverted person, you still, I mean, look, what do introverts do? They go, they play World of Warcraft, they play Magic, whatever. Mm-hmm. Like, they still need, most of our community are introverts, right? Mm-hmm. All introversion doesn't mean that you love solitary confinement. No. It just simply means that, you know,
you get energy
in order to
alone.
Recharge, you need some time to yourself and you get back out there. But nobody wants to be completely isolated. So
I do kind of wonder, you know, God always does everything for, like, a million reasons. And, like, one of the reasons I think about with COVID is that we all had our phones, our Facebook and all that stuff. Those can be an addition to actual connections face-to-face with people, but they shouldn't be the sole way that you communicate with other human beings. The face-to-face contact, the physical touch, like, all those things, they're very important for human, like, for our human, like, our well-being and stuff. And I think that COVID helped us see that, because it was almost like a world in which you push forward so far that now that was all you had for communication, and everything was very, very disjointed and separated. And I think that it kind of gave you that feeling Well, actually, I do want to talk to people. When we went to get our Starbucks drinks today, like, I did want to talk to the people behind the counter and the people in line behind me.
We had a lot of fun.
And we had a lot of fun with it. And I think that a lot of people are missing that. Another crazy thing is, again, you never saw Chitty Chitty Bang Bang, but they basically take all the kids from this town and make them slaves in this underground whatever. So there are no kids in the entire town. So when these kids happen into the town, everybody's like, oh my gosh, because they haven't seen kids in so long. And it feels like that when you take your kids out in public, because everybody has, obviously, with the pandemic, people have kept their children inside. And there's such a sweetness about kids, especially when, you know, they're not your issue to deal with, you know? So if you just see them going by, you're like, that's such a sweet little boy.
Sweet little child.
They don't see him when he chucks his milk on the floor. But anyway, so people, you see them just, like, wanting to be so close to the kids and, like, saying hi and, like, really, like, it's can almost feel a little bit creepy, but at the same time, I understand where we're at and that we're in a place where people haven't been able. If you don't have kids of your own, you've gone, as long as we've gone without really seeing other people, these people have gone without seeing children. And children are so, like, innocent in a sense. I know they're not innocent. They have all their problems. They have their terrible twos. They have their terrible whatevers. But they're just so, they're more to their natural state, and their reactions are, they don't think through, let me try to manipulate. You know what I mean? Like, they're just authentic little guys, and it's fun to be around them and stuff. And I think that people have missed that.
Mm-hmm.
You know?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah. So at least I learned how to love. Like, that's an important line. That's an important line. And, you know, yeah, it's a little bit simplistic, blah, blah, blah. But that's a big thing, guys. You know? And at the end of the day, that's how you judge whether you've had a full life or not.
Yeah.
You know, trust me. It ain't going to be about, oh, I made this many, blah, blah, blah. It's like, did you love the people around you? And did the people around you know you love them?
Yeah.
And so that's like, honestly, that's why yesterday was such a beautiful moment for me. Watching the NBA Western Conference Finals.
Mm-hmm.
Because that to me was just such a pure and beautiful moment. And obviously, you know, for men in general, and, you know, black men in particular, the whole bullshit about, oh, men don't cry and men don't have public displays of affection and all this other just ridiculous nonsense that people have been inundated with.
Mm-hmm.
And it was just really cool to see that. And so I wanna actually show it. Let me see if I can get this eardrop to work. Oh, look, they got Radharani on there. So I just wanted to show that because I think that that's the best way to close it out. At the end of the day, that's the line. If I die young, I'll die with some love in my heart.
Yep.
And that's a beautiful thing if we can pull it off. But I don't know if we're going to pull it off or not. Actually, no, it should be in here, right? All right, well.
It's just not.
It's not in the books, but it was a beautiful moment. But you guys, I actually put it up on our Instagram, so if you want to check it out, check it out. There you go. What do you get the song?
Oh, 9.7.
Yeah, I can rock with that. 9.7. Good song. Very, very good song. Been out.
Sorry out.
Gone. Find somebody to love.